We are pleased to welcome on stage Mr. Ashish Bharatram. Sir, get your bearing for a few minutes while I introduce you. Chairman and MD SRF Group, Mr. Ram has been the MD of SRF since 2007 and was also appointed the chairman in 2022. And under his strong leadership, SRF has grown into a major global conglomerate with business spreading across a diverse portfolio of fluorochemicals, specialty chemicals, packaging films, technical textiles, and coated and laminated fibers, wherein it is number one. Mr. Ram is also a global speaker and has authored articles on Indian scenario, Indian economic scenario, and entrepreneurship. He's had stints over DCM Toyota, SRF Finance, and SRF overseas, where he held functions like sales, strategy, marketing, and total quality management. He holds a degree in economics from Delhi University and an MBA from Johnson Graduate School of Management, Cornell University. Sir, welcome on stage. And to lead a discussion with him, we call upon our MD, Mr. Krishna Kumar Karwa. Over to you, gentlemen.
Good afternoon, everybody. And thank you, Ashish, for taking time out and agreeing to address this vast audience. And first of all, congratulations. This year, SRF is celebrating 50 years of manufacturing excellence. It's a big achievement, and today manufacturing is the theme, but you guys have been at it for now 50 years.
First of all, thank you, Krishna, for having me here. I know when the two of you came and spoke to me about this, I was a bit hesitant, but then I said, you know, you were one of the first people to discover SRF, I think maybe 12, 14 years ago.
Thank you very much.
I said, I owe this to you guys, so I said, let me do this. And yes, this year is special for us because 50 years of manufacturing, you know, sometimes you just go with the flow, don't realize that some of these milestones come on your way, but it is something that, you know, we are proud of, and we will do something to celebrate this later in the year.
Thank you. And so thank you for acknowledging our contribution or in terms of identifying SRF 14 years ago. So Ashish, yes, a long way you have been running the show from 2002 and now as chairman, and from 2007 as the MD. So yes, you have seen the whole transformation, or you have been instrumental in the transformation as far as SRF itself is concerned. But at one level, possibly it also means the whole transformation of the spec chem business itself, and how you think the journey has been so far, and what is your take for the next 10 years as such?
So I think, you know, if I break it up, I talk about SRF for a second. You know, when we got into this business, I think it was a bit accidental. You know, we got into R&D because with the Montreal Protocol in the late 90s, early 2000s, we had to substitute from CFCs to HFCs, and no Western player was willing to give us technology. So we had to get into R&D really as a defensive mechanism if we wanted to stay in that space. And then once we got into HFCs and started creating our own technology, we realized that we had this R&D team that was capable of doing a lot more. And that's how the spec chem business started in the middle of 2000. I think the first 5-7 years was a learning journey. We made a lot of mistakes. We were a bit more product out in the sense that we would go to the market and say that, listen, this is what we've developed. Would you like to buy it? And customers were more like, listen, forget what you're doing. Can you do this for us? And I think that learning was a 5-7 year process. Once we got comfortable with that, I think we really started understanding different nuances. I think if we were at chemistry 101, maybe 15 years ago, we've probably gone up 7 or 8x on complexity. What was largely a fluorine-based story for us, I think has moved much beyond fluorine. So now it's not just fluorine, but also complexity in different chemistries. I think to the second part of your question, I feel very passionate about the fact that I think India does have an opportunity to play a differentiating role in the spec chem business. I think what we've explored over the last maybe 5 years is really tip of the iceberg, but the journey that lies ahead could be very exciting, and maybe we'll talk about that later.
Thank you. Yeah, so journey, I mean, it's a long journey, and you as the promoter of the company, etc., you have a 10-20 year vision. But here, most of us are public market investors, and we don't have a vision beyond 2-3 years. And in that context, if you see the last 2 years, I think the whole spec chem business seems to be in kind of a consolidation, and reflective in the stock market valuation or other stock prices also. So was it, and now this whole China plus one was the theme maybe 2-2.5 years ago. Where does it stand now? Like, did we become over exuberant, or this is just a consolidation phase, etc.? What is your take on?
So I'll speak for myself, Krishna, and I'll, you know, whenever I met with the investor community, even over the last 5-7 years, I said, please understand that China is the behemoth in this room, and that will never disappear. Okay, China had probably one of the toughest COVID lockdowns of any country. So I think when that happened, we all got a lot of opportunity to, let's say, take advantage of the short-term opportunity that came from there. But I think, you know, China should not be looked upon only from a scale perspective. I think we have to accept the fact that even on technology and capability, what China has achieved over the last 10, 15 years has been absolutely phenomenal. So, I mean, just moving away from spec chem for a second, you know, you take the EV story. I think everybody in this room is fairly clear that what they've achieved in EV is at a level where nobody in the Western world, except probably Tesla, is ever going to be able to take on. So I think even in the chemical space, you know, there are some good companies over there. Yes, but there are also a lot of companies which have built themselves around lots of government subsidies, lots of freebies, etc. And the second element, I think, which I have noticed, at least in the Chinese, is that, if I may use a strong word, they have a much more of a gambling mentality. They're happy with, you know, taking on the market, even if they lose money for 2 years, but they will go all out for market share, and then vice versa, they're also happy when the times are good to be able to make good money. I think what we are seeing in the last couple of years is a lot of capacity that's come up in China, and at this stage, really just going all out to grab as much market share as they can from wherever they can.
Zero. So, Ashish, you know, it's very interesting, you know, when we talk about the journey from 2022, and in some of the work that we've done, we've seen from what McKinsey says that India stands out in terms of shareholder return. So, as an industry, we have given some 14-15% CAGR returns, TSR, and this is miles ahead of even the innovators, the Chinese companies, the European companies. You know, what sets India, you know, that, you know, it's done so well in chemical industry?
I think one, of course, the chemical industry in India is at a very, very nascent stage. So even if you look at whatever we may have done over the last 10 years, our global market share probably has moved up from 3% maximum to 4%. So at that level, when you're trying to take some market share from China, which is closer to 30%, you're still at a, you know, I think we are a microcosm in the context of where the world is. So whatever we've done is really not made broad impacts into market shares on a global scale. So, you know, it's like, and that's why, to some extent, to Krishna's earlier point, what will make spec chem succeed in the future is companies that don't look at this as a short-term opportunity, but companies that realize that this is going to be a lot of hard work, but a hard work that will pay off in time. So I think a lot of easy pickings have been done by a lot of companies in the last 5-7 years. The road ahead is going to be tougher, but for those companies which are willing to make that sort of bet, also very rewarding.
All right, so just to follow up on that, so we know that, you know, China is around for a long period of time. So when you try and identify, you know, either molecules or the chemistries, and you know that you need to compete with the Chinese companies, how do you go about that? I appreciate the confidentiality, but whatever you can share for the benefit of the investors.
I think, yeah, at the highest level, you know, you look at technologies which are, let's say, difficult to crack. Sometimes it's your access to raw materials or byproducts that others may not have access to. It is also the stickiness of the customer to certain products. So I think it's not one answer fits all, but a combination of a lot of factors that go into this. Sometimes you take calls from a strategic perspective because it may not be the most rewarding product, but your customer is very keen that you do it for him, and you will get rewarded in some other form somewhere else. So it's a series of, I would say, you know, variables that go into the decision-making thing. But I think the point that I was trying to make earlier is that unless companies actually spend on capability and actually make, let's say, research and development the core element, operational excellence, I think, has to happen. That's a given. And a lot of companies can do that. But I think the big differentiating factor is those companies which are willing to invest in true research and development.
So coming back to, one is this China plus one, which you very well alluded to. I believe now even companies out of Europe are struggling, chemical companies out of Europe, due to high energy costs and inability or unwillingness of people to work, etc. And so what is your take, and has this opened up a new vista of opportunity for companies like from India and from you?
No, I think that's clearly a new trend that's visible. I think what started with the energy crisis in Europe after the Russia-Ukraine war, we've seen energy prices come down, but I don't think they're going to come down to the levels that we saw pre-Russia-Ukraine. I have to be careful of, I mean, I was reading an article about a very senior CEO of one of the big chemical companies in Europe, and he actually made this comment saying that Europe seems to have sort of lost the plot because, you know, with so much pressure from the Greens, etc., and so on, you know, the competitiveness of Europe is sort of disappearing literally all the time. That being one element, the second element being that, again, you know, I don't want to be politically incorrect, but I don't think the Europeans want to work as hard as a lot of us in this part of the world or in, let's say, developing parts of the world. And especially, I think the younger generation there is not that excited about the chemical industry as maybe the elder generation was. So I think it's going to be a sort of natural I don't want to use the word death, but natural coming down of the industry over there. And that will throw opportunities because Europe will always be a consumer. So if they were doing, let's say, five steps, they could come to a situation saying that, listen, we'll keep our IPR protection really with the last one or two steps, but let's outsource the, you know, the N-2 or N-3. And I think that sort of a process is going to get, sort of pick up momentum.
So would it be correct to say then, I mean, there's a lot of talent available in Europe and seniors, etc. Will that talent pool now become available to companies like you for as consultants or whatever, and will that help the process?
No, absolutely. And I mean, it's not just us, but I think there will be a lot of companies looking at picking up talent, especially people who are close to retirement or, you know, just retired, because these are people who still have energy in them. They have some incredible experience, access to technology that they've developed. So you're absolutely right that over the next 5 to 10 years at least, these people will be there. I'm not so sure what sort of capability will lie maybe, you know, 10 years down the playing field, but at least at the present, next 5 to 10 years, I think that's going to be an opportunity.
So how is the scene in terms of taking forward from, in terms of talent in India, in terms of, we find that whenever sectors are in boom, like a few years ago, IT companies were struggling with talent and a lot of job hopping, etc., and compensation went through the roof. How are scenes in your industry, availability of young talent, people wanting to join, and whoever is there a cost inflation big time or it's stable?
Yeah, I think, you know, the positive side of any down cycle is that the attrition challenge becomes lesser of a challenge. So I would say the last year or so has been relatively more peaceful on the talent side as far as the industry is concerned. But I think the bigger challenge, and this is not linked, I would say, just to people, but I'll make a broader point, is that, you know, all of us who've been in the industry so far have always looked at Gujarat as a state to go to, because that's where the ecosystem of the chemical industry really developed over the last 20 years. I think Gujarat, and rightfully so, is saying that, listen, we want to move up the curve, so we are looking at, you know, higher level industries like semiconductors, automobiles, and so on, not that interested in chemicals. Now, unfortunately, there is really no other state which is putting its hands up and saying that, listen, we want to create an ecosystem for chemicals, come and invest over here. So I think one big challenge that we're going to have is actually this, I would say, switch from Gujarat to looking at other opportunities or other states. Linked to that, if you don't create opportunities because of other constraints, whatever are the chemical engineers coming out, chemical scientists coming out, first of all, let's be honest, probably only 20-25% of them are employable. Okay, I think 70% of them have to get trained. Sorry. And that training can take a year, 2 years before you get to that level where they're really capable. So I think the couple of challenges that I see over the next 2 to 3 years is somebody stepping up to say, come and invest in our state. We are going to be excited about the chemical industry. And I think the ongoing challenge is going to be around capability of people. But again, the silver lining, I think, is going to be that, even in this budget, the Honorable Finance Minister spoke about skilling being a focus area for a lot of companies and those of us who have CSR budgets. So I think in the next 2 to 3 years, you're going to see companies trying to figure out how we can use CSR funds to improve the capability of engineers coming out of colleges and so on.
Thank you. Yeah, Nira?
So Ashish, two set of questions and probably interrelated as well. Given the fact that we are still nascent in terms of evolution of chemical industry in India, we still a lot of things that gets imported into the country. Do you expect some of these global majors, primarily looked at China, now try and set up a base in India? That's number one. And likewise, for people like you, very strong in one particular chemistries, do you think that the existing leaders will cross-pollinate into other chemistries? How do you think how this will evolve?
So, Nirav, I think the first question, yes, I think they will want to look at India. But again, I don't want to be pessimistic over here, but for a foreign company to come and set up a big base in India in the chemical industry is not easy. Okay, and I'm saying that, companies like ours who've been in this industry still find challenges in dealing with the ecosystem. For foreign companies coming and doing it on their own, I think is going to be close to impossible. And to some extent, the proof is in the pudding because nobody's really come and done anything, right? So, yes, you could potentially see JVs down the line. JVs could be, I don't know, at a big scale, early to say, but that could be potentially the way forward. Second was, so I think, yes, I said, we started with fluorine and then have moved into products much beyond fluorine. I think that same is going to happen with others. A lot of people have asked me, so-and-so is getting into fluorine, so-and-so is getting into fluorine. And I said, listen, it's obvious. If fluorine is an opportunity, why is it that others are not going to? The key is that for companies like SRF, we can't remain at the same molecules that, we were doing 10 years ago. We have to get into more complex molecules, which are even more difficult because the learning curve cannot be done away with. So anybody getting into fluorine cannot get into the most complicated molecule on day one. They will have to go through the pains of learning what the molecule is about and go through that pain process.
So does this mean, Ashish, that you and your friends in the ecosystem, like today maybe you're focused on more on the agrochem chain and the pharma chain, and there are so many now opportunities coming up in the renewable energy and battery chemicals, etc., green hydrogen, and connected to that there is a whole chemical chain. So in the next 10 years we should see across the industry a transformation coming. What are the challenges and opportunities according to you?
So you're absolutely right, Krishna, that world will move beyond agro. I think for a company like ours, our first step is that beyond agro, we want to look at pharma, and we've started doing a fair amount of work. It may not show in the numbers immediately, but I can only state that the work that's been done will start showing. And again, it took us 5 years to understand agro. It's taken us probably 2 to 3 years to understand what it takes to succeed in pharma. But yes, you're right, opportunities are going to emerge from the energy sector or from the electronics sector, sustainability/climate change. These are all going to be verticals that will offer opportunities. We are going to be looking at all these. One of the reasons we have not got straight into battery chemicals is that I think there is still a flux in terms of where that technology is going to finally sort of settle down, and we don't want to end up investing at the moment not knowing which way it's headed. So in certain cases, I think it's good to be a leader. In certain cases, I think it's good to just wait and watch and not necessarily be a leader.
Thank you. And Ashish, in terms of one more transformation, we are very good at process innovation, and that's across our industry per se.
And do you think that it's a question of time before now companies in our ecosystem, including SRF, have the financial muscle to even get into product innovation or new products, etc.? Or is there an opportunity, and what are the conflicts, if any?
So I think, Krishna, we've made, we've taken small steps on the refrigerant gas side. So, you know, as we all know that HCFC-22, which has been one of the key refrigerant gases used in the air conditioning industry, will have a major phase down starting 2025. So 2 years ago, we developed our own drop-in patent product 467A, and that will be a complete, completely drop-in replaceable for HCFC-22. So that's the first product patent that we've got. But you're right that I think going forward, a lot more work needs to be done. You know, the question I asked, or I posed to my team and I challenged them, is I said, listen, in every case, we are following the Western world with a product. So, you know, HFCs was their sort of development. We came into it maybe 8-10 years later. They're moving into HF. They moved into HFOs 3-4 years ago. We'll get into it in a couple of years. I said, post HFOs, how do we challenge ourselves to say that we are going to be at the same level of saying that we can develop a product just as quickly as the Western world can? So I think our mindset is definitely changing. I think the challenge does not look or sound insurmountable today. I think people are more open to taking it up. And I think there's a sense of pride saying that, listen, if we could have achieved this in 467A, there's no reason why we can't do this in times to come.
I think we have lot of questions from the audience. So if you have something, Nirav, otherwise...
Yeah, just one more question, and you know, it's hard to get men, so I want audience to take benefit of that as well.
Actually, there's been two.
So Ashish, assuming that, you know, the global guys find it difficult to set their foot in India and get a scale, but they still want to benefit from, obviously, the cost structure and our capabilities. Does that mean that CMO then becomes a big opportunity, and how is SRF exploiting that?
Yeah, so, you know, I mean, I think CMO, CDMO, I mean, these are all lovely phrases. I think we all do parts of it in some form or another. So, you know, I mean, I always say that, listen, if there is a problem that needs to be solved, can we be a solution provider to it, right? Now, in some cases, the customer might just say that, listen, I have a very basic technology. Can you work on this for us? So that means that we have to do a lot more work in the R&D side, etc., to come up with a solution. In some cases, the package will be far more well-developed. It's less work. In some cases, you know, I mean, they say that, listen, we don't have anything, in which case the IPR actually belongs to us. At the broadest level, I think we have to define our job as finding a solution to the problem that the customer has. Now, whether that's a JV, whether it's this model or that model, I think we have to be open to all of those.
We can open the...
You mentioned that China is a, you know, behemoth, and he's going to remain like that, right? And they just go out to say, get the market share, and like the entire industry is sneezing, right? So, while side, we say that, you know, our industry is going to become from $50 billion to $900 billion, trillion dollar over the next 20, 25 years, while China continues to remain. So how do you see this, because it's a very large growth, right? So how do you see this playing out over this period, right? And secondly, every time there is always some sort of disruption which happens. So there's a chemistry disruption also happening, part of the growth happening towards biochemistry side. So where does, you know, India kind of stand and take lead? How do you see this growth coming out?
So to the first question, I'd put it this way, that we've seen this cycle in China many a time. When they go massively capital intensive, they add capacities beyond anybody's imagination. But they're the first ones to also mothball capacities when the time comes. So it's like they're fighting, and if they find a day comes when it's not working, they just shut it down and, you know, so be it. Now, in their system, who takes the hit for this, etc., is a little bit of a black box. And I think, you know, I was with a very dear friend of mine who's on our board. And he says, the more and more I try to understand China, the less I understand it. Okay, so to some extent, I think China is a bit of an enigma on that front. But we've seen prices correct time and time again. So we've seen this happen in 2015-16, where they came up with big capacities and did the same thing. But then suddenly, 2 years later, 3 years later, you find that half these capacities have disappeared. So to that extent, I think we have to keep chipping away. The point I made earlier is because of geopolitical situations also, we know that nobody wants to be dependent completely on China. So everybody wants to buy from us even today, but they want to buy at a Chinese pricing. Right? So all that they're saying is that, listen, we are very happy buying from you, but at China pricing. What that does is to some extent answer the second question, which is makes us go back to the drawing board, relook at all our processes, relook at whether we just need to look at this completely with a different lens, see how you can make a 9-step process a 5-step process, how can you use, reduce your solvents, reuse your solvents, whatever it is. But relook at the entire picture from a different lens, because sometimes when you hit with a crisis, it's the best opportunity to actually tighten your shoes. And also, I think, just relook at whether you were getting a bit complacent. You know, I say this with an SRF now. I think we had such a great run for 5 years that this downturn of the last 1 year has been a blessing. Because if there was any element of complacency that was setting in, I think this was the wake-up call that we needed. Right? So to your question, to some extent, I would say that each company will have to figure out how they want to chip away at that gap between 50 billion and whatever that number may be.
And SRF has been a great story, 100x in the last 10, 12 years. And I remember Krishna sending me a report when I was in the Edelweiss. What's your vision next 10 years? How large SRF could become, you know, given the opportunity set and all?
So I would probably want to answer this question a few months from now, and then I'll tell you another thing, because we're actually in the midst of our next 5-year cycle of planning. I don't want to say anything now because it'll go back to the team, and you know, I don't want it to be either a constraint or whatever. So certain things we'll keep for the future. No, it's not that hard either.
You mentioned about JVs. What is your sense, if you were a global player, what would be the pros and cons or the deterrents for inbound M&A transaction or an alliance with an Indian chemical company?
So I think, you know, my gut tells me that European companies are going to start looking at this more aggressively. Certain European companies have been very pro-China. I think, I mean, again, there's no secret in the room, but companies like BASF have looked at China really as their go-to country for manufacturing, not so much towards India. But, it's a question of time that, you know, people are either going to look at full-out acquisitions or look at JVs. My gut tells me that, you know, it's possible that companies might just look at not such capable companies, just because they at least give them the basic ecosystem around which they can build their strengths, and maybe cheaper for them to buy than companies which are really highly capable. So time will tell, but my gut tells me that yes, you will see more action on the M&A front over the next 3 to 5 years.
Any particular spaces where you think Indian players will stand out?
Difficult for me to say.
Any plans to enter the value-added fluoropolymer space after PTFE? Are you planning to go downstream, considering the fact that a lot of global peers like 3M and all are shutting down in Europe, on one hand.
Yeah.
On the other hand, I was just thinking the Chinese capacity is so big. So how are we going to, as an Indian manufacturer, how are we going to plan?
So two things. Answer to the first one is yes. So at the moment, for example, we started with bulk. We moved into fine cuts. We moved into free flow. And the next will be modified, which is the value-added polymer. So that's going to be the next stage. To that extent, I think Krishna's question earlier in terms of how are you going to do that, we are going to get skills from the Western world to help us move down that road much faster than what we have, because like you said, there are plants shutting down in Europe, there are going to be high quality resources available who are going to be unemployed over there. So that's the first part of the story. I think we all have to again take into fact that the entire world will not go to China. So if capacity is shut down in Europe, nobody is going to depend 100% on China. So any element of de-risking from China means that the opportunity will really come to India. And in fluoropolymers, to a large extent, let's face it, Gujarat Fluoro is the leader. And our job really over the next few years is to try and build our base in that space.
But Chinese capacities are so big. And, there's a lot of dumping taking place from China to USA via Mexico and through agents and traders. So I was wondering that Europe, EEC has raised the duties on battery chemicals as well as fluoropolymers. And even in USA, the custom duties have raised to 25% to 30%. So people, Chinese manufacturers are circumventing these duties by backdoor entries.
So that's a cat and mouse game that goes on. It's the same whether it's fluoropolymers, we see that in refrigerant gases also, where you know they've been trying to circumvent it, selling gas from Turkey. Now, I mean, there's no manufactured ref gas in Turkey, but Turkey supplying to the US, I mean, obviously makes no sense. So I think it's a question of, you know, who catches whom at what stage. But there's no doubt that the US has become far, far more, energetic about circumvention than they did in the past. So the Chinese will keep doing what they've done all their lives. So their job will be to find new countries through whom they can circumvent. And I think it's a question of the authorities in the US being more this thing. But I mean, if we were to start looking at business models from the perspective that, you know, China will only circumvent all its life, then it's going to be difficult for us to get into more spaces. But I think somewhere we have to have the confidence that, one, we will compete with them. And I have never, never feared competing with the Chinese on cost. I think it's more to do with the fact that, you know, I mean, their desire for returns at times can be so abysmal that you have absolutely, you know, like I said, they're such gamblers that losing money for 2 years has no meaning for them because they're okay making money in that 1 year and making up all the losses. You know, I think we're all people who like, you know, earnings which are more stable, etc. So I think that's the little bit of a mindset that is different between the Chinese and us.
But the China plus one thought globally is there, getting stronger.
You know, I mean, I sort of alluded to this. What does one, as an entrepreneur, as a businessman running a company, what is it that you want for the government? It's not, I'm not looking for subsidies, I'm looking for enablers. So I'm not getting into a blame game, but you really need a new state to step up and say, I'm going to create an ecosystem for the chemical industry to come in. What the part of the problem is that today when we go and get land anywhere, we end up spending so much in the development of the land that the Chinese don't do that. For the Chinese, it's actually plug and play. You know, so one major advantage they have is they can go to a chemical zone somewhere, they will get power, they'll get steam, they'll get connected to the ETP, their land is given literally a throwaway price as long as you're making investments of a certain amount. Here today, if I have to go and buy land, you're looking at over 1.5 crore, 2 crores an acre in certain states. You just think about how that impacts your initial investments because the land has to be bought today. And then you have to put up your own power plant, you have to put up your steam generation, your ETP. So by the time you've actually kicked off with even one productive plant, nearly 400 to 500 crores have just gone into the side stuff, which in China would be literally like a plug and play free of cost. You know? So I think the mindset needs to be that, listen, I think the chemical industry can be a game changer for India. If exports has to be something that we keep talking about, then our mindset needs to move, saying that, listen, in the next 5 to 10 years, what is it that we need to provide? And that's all we need to provide. We just need to think of 4 or 5 really serious zones where this happens. You know, we've had the development of 4 PCPIRs, but for all practical purposes, only Dahej, which was developed into any sort of a zone. But you leave that aside, I don't even remember what the other 3 PCPIRs are.
Is the market access improving? Suppose you do it in India, then access to the Indian market versus imports, has that improved?
Yeah, no doubt. I think import substitution, for example, will be a theme that's going to play out very well. And I think that's, again, an opportunity that we'll all be looking at.
So there, does the cost differentials are papered over? How does it work?
See, I think in our case, what's happened is our total investment now in Dahej has reached levels of close to 10,000 crores, right? So when you have a scale of that size, then that 300 crores that we may have put in initially becomes a very minuscule part. So today for me to compete out of Dahej is not an issue. I was talking to you the challenges for somebody who's starting afresh. That's the challenge anybody has.
So if you take about in current context, prices of many product has come down drastically, like key product DFMP, price collects around $70 to around $30, $35. So now, as you can see, you think you need to focus more on the volume and hence the whenever you do capex budgeting, you think your IIR or the ROC metric has to be torn down later to chase the volume, or probably you will be happy deferring capex by 1 or 2 years till the sanity prevails.
No, I think we were always clear in our minds that the prices will come down. Okay, so I think that what's happened in this case is probably happened faster because of what's happened in China over the last 2 years. Yes, what it means is that we are obviously looking at our cost structures, like I explained to Vikas, that we are already finding, you know, ways of being able to make up a lot of the price differential. And we will obviously look at the volume play. But, you know, the same story actually, you know, we look at DFPA, but the same thing actually played out in the trifluoro space maybe 6-7 years ago. In the trifluoro space, we were at, you know, at a higher price, the Chinese came in, we've, you know, worked on our cost structures, and today we have nearly 70-75% of the global trifluoro space. So you can be rest assured there is not an inch we are going to give away on the difluoro. Okay, DFPA is going to be one of our key products. We will fight it out on price. We also know that, again, based on whatever we've seen, prices will recover a little bit. They will never go back to where they were. But the work that we would have done on the cost side would more than make up for it, along with what we will work on the additional volumes.
And on the CapEx plan, depending on the current situation, are you toning down your IRR assumption, or probably you are happy with deferring CapEx?
No, I don't think we will be looking. I think honestly speaking, the way we have to look at it is that on all the new products that we do, right, pricing is fixed. The difference is, earlier on, let's say that we would take 5 years for the pricing to start changing. Now that the challenge that's been thrown to the team is, let's say that starts happening in 3 years. So if today we have started the work based on a certain process, the R&D team is already working on how to disrupt that process. So what we are saying is that if something is being sold at, let's say, $100, and the contract said that for the next 5 years, even with volumes going up, that may 100 may come down to 80, but with higher volumes, we are saying in our minds, assume that in 5 years it'll come down to 50, in 3 years it'll come down to 80, and start working on what cost structure work we can do on the process improvement side to make sure that we don't lose the absolute margin. So we are not, at the moment, there is still no desire from our side to play around with IRRs. Our aspirational IRRs have to remain where they are.
Thanks,
Ron. Yeah. No, it's. I think it's more noise because, you know, the typical situation in Europe is they sometimes have the tendency to throw the baby out with the bathwater. And I think if you look at that list, if there are 90,000 chemicals that will get affected by that. So suddenly, when you get into the depth of it, you realize that if you actually go through with that regulation, then that's the end of Europe, because there's no way you can do without those 90,000 chemicals. But let me also tell you that there is a lot of work happening behind the scenes. There is a white paper that is floating that will ensure that this will not happen.
Ashish, so your foray into aluminium foils, I mean, what's the thought process behind it, and maybe some bigger picture if you can share?
So I think, Krishna, I mean, we sort of got into aluminium foil firstly because it's an adjacency to packaging. So we said, listen, we need to look. So, you know, at one time we were basically a polyester foil manufacturer. Then we said we need to look at other substrates, and we said, okay, BOPP makes sense because there's a lot of value add. And then we said that, listen, beyond that, where do we go? And we said aluminium foil. But aluminium foil initially from the packaging perspective, but I think there are, again, applications of aluminium foil that will go into the battery space, battery separator films. Aluminium foil plays a role there. There's another application which is AC fins. Okay. Again, most of the AC fins today, which are aluminium based, are all imported from China. We already have a lock-in with the AC customers because of refgas. So down the line, once we sort of understand the aluminium foil processing part well, our goal will be to get into adjacencies like that. So clearly, it's linked to the three verticals of energy, electronics, and climate change sustainability.
And I believe that there is an uptick in the whole BOPP, BOPET films also. Is there, I mean, it's a cyclical business at the end of the day, and we saw the numbers of your peers also. Everybody seems to be seeing early signs of an uptick. Is the cycle uptick now, or what's your take?
I put it this way, the worst is behind us. I think, you know, if you look at any mathematical analysis, the supply-demand gap that was there is shrinking. So, you know, whether it is a question of a year, year and a half, one doesn't know. But I think you will start seeing the...
In the midst of an update.
Yeah, the worst is behind for sure.
Ashish, you know, SR is well said, you know, leader in chemical industry. Now, as an owner and an operating CEO, you know, where do you spend 70% of your time? What are the things that you focus on for that 10-year journey?
Yeah, so I think a majority of the time goes into strategy and people. Okay, so I probably spend 10% of my time on daily management. So, I mean, for example, I won't even know at what price you're buying a product or selling a product. I mean, you have to empower your team to do that. But I think majority of my time would be strategy. What are the opportunities? What are the risks? Can we create an opportunity out of a risk, etc. So mind is always working on that angle. And the second part is really the team. You know, where are the risks in the team? Which are the parts of the team that need to be strengthened? Succession planning, so things like that.
Perfect, thank you. Maybe we call for one more last question.
I think, Meet, any question? Otherwise, we can end.
He asked me all the questions upstairs.
Okay. I think we can end then.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Not at all, my pleasure.
Thank you for your time, man. It was a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ram, Mr. Sheth, and Mr. Karwa. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll disperse for lunch now, and lunch is served outside. May I request all to reconvene at 2? Thank you.